This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Global Report. I'm your host, Lily Ong. We have with us this morning the Minister of Defense for the largest military in Southeast Asia, as well as one of the most powerful military in the world. Welcome to the show, Minister Ryamizard Ryacudu.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. Saya menyampaikan selamat bertemu juga, dan saya merasa senang dapat bertemu dari teman-teman wartawan dari Amerika.
It is very nice to see you, and I'm very delighted today that I can meet my colleagues and especially the press from the United States of America.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you for meeting time. Now, before we start today, Minister, I would like to express my heartfelt condolence to the tragedy of Lion Air Flight 610.
Kami ingin mengucapkan turut berduka cita Pak atas kejadian insiden Lion Air pesawat penerbangan JT610.
Terima kasih atas ucapan bela sungkawanya. Ini akan saya sampaikan kepada yang terkena musibah. Kita mintakan doanya saja agar keluarga korban tabah dalam menghadapi cobaan ini.
Thank you so very much for kindly showing your empathy and sympathy, especially for the current incident of Lion Air JT 610. And we really wish all your support and your prayer, especially for the casualties and the victims of this air crash incident.
Thank you, Minister. Now, Minister, I'd like to talk about some of the counter-terrorism efforts that's been going on. I know that in 2002, with the Bali bombing, terrorism has catapulted to the top of the priority list for nations of the, you know, the maritime nations in Southeast Asia, and it has remained there since.
Jadi kami ingin bicara Pak terkait dengan kebijakan kontraterorisme untuk Indonesia ini pada kawasan. Seperti Bapak ketahui bahwa sejak 2002 itu serangan Al-Qaeda itu di Bali itu menjadi prioritas utama dalam penanganan terorisme baik di Indonesia maupun kawasan, Pak. Siap.
However, we know that even before 2002, the countries have seen a need for closer collaboration when it comes to security matters. So we have the 1997 ASEAN Declaration on Transnational Crime. We had the 2001 ASEAN Declaration on Joint Action to Counter Terrorism. And in 2007, we had the ASEAN Convention on Countering Terrorism.
Dalam kaitan ini, Pak, jauh sebelum adanya serangan bom Bali sudah ada komitmen-komitmen untuk kawasan bekerja sama, Pak. Ya, di mana pada tahun 1997 ada deklarasi ASEAN untuk bekerja sama dalam menangani transnational crime. Kemudian pada tahun 2001 ada deklarasi ASEAN untuk penanganan terorisme, termasuk 2007 ada konvensi untuk kesepakatan ASEAN untuk bekerja sama dalam menangani ancaman terorisme ini.
Now, looking back at all the counterterrorism measures and instruments, would you share some of their features and their extent of success, please?
Terkait dengan apa yang sudah dikerjasamakan, Pak, mungkin Bapak bisa menyampaikan dari konsep-konsep yang sebelumnya, Pak, apakah sudah ada kesuksesan-kesuksesan dalam penanganan terorisme tersebut, Pak?
Ya, memang untuk Indonesia ini kan tidak ada musuh atau bermusuhan dengan negara manapun. Kita selalu mengajak untuk berteman, karena prinsip dari undang-undang dasar kita, ya, pembukaannya ikut mengamankan dunia, berarti ya kita harus berteman semua. Musuhnya ada atau ancamannya yang saya sampaikan adalah diantaranya ya teroris, kemudian ancaman lain bencana alam, itu ancaman yang nyata. Dan penanganan ini memerlukan kerjasama yang kuat, baik di dalam negeri, tidak hanya polisi dengan tentara saja, tapi seluruh masyarakat harus ikut serta untuk menangani teroris ini. Kemudian antara negara juga, karena terorisnya lintas negara, ya, kita juga mengatasinya bersama-sama dengan negara-negara semua begitu.
Indeed, it is very important to note that Indonesia will never consider any nation, especially in the region, as a threat. We never consider any threat coming from other countries. But the way we defend our, we design our defense strategy is really based on the non-traditional threat, which is very factual and realistic, ranging from terrorism and natural disasters. Based on this factual and non-traditional threat, then it is like a foundation for us to cooperate among nations in this world. So it is imperative that among nations in the region, we have to stand together to fight this common enemy. And the common enemy as the foundation of our cooperation, one of among others, is the threat of terrorism. So it is very important that we have to have strong action and strong standpoint against this threat for humanity.
Thank you, Minister. In fact, when the ASEAN Convention on Countering Terrorism came about, one of the biggest resistance obstacles were getting the member nations to see that terrorism is not just a local phenomenon, but a regional, a global phenomenon. Is that correct? Was that one of the challenges?
Jadi pada saat waktu konvensi masalah terorisme itu disetujui oleh ASEAN, Pak, pada 2004 itu, Pak, dan 2002, itu kami masih melihat ada beberapa negara ASEAN yang masih resisten, belum menyetujui dengan konsep ancaman terorisme bersama itu, Pak. Apakah Bapak bisa benar melihat seperti itu awalnya?
Saya mendengar begitu, tapi saya pada waktu itu posisi saya belum belum sampai ke sana. Saya kedudukan saya sebagai Kepala Staf TNI Angkatan Darat. Tetapi yang saya tahu sekarang, ini semuanya bersama. Tidak ada perbedaan, ya, satu suara, satu tindakan, ya. Ini yang sekarang ini. Yes, karena kita tahu dulu kan kita menghadapi Al-Qaeda, ya, teroris generasi yang pertama. Yang kedua adalah ISIS, itu adalah yang generasi kedua. Nah, kemudian setelah dihancurkan di Timur Tengah, dia kembali ke negara masing-masing. Nah, kita menghadapi generasi tiga, yaitu pejuang-pejuang yang pulang. Nah, ini pulang ini memang harus lebih hati-hati lagi, karena mereka sudah pengalaman perang dan sudah tahu taktik dan strategi untuk bertempur, untuk melakukan teroris, ya. Untuk itu kita bersama-sama untuk menghadapi itu. Bersama-sama dan semuanya sepakat.
Indeed, when this ASEAN Convention on Counter-Terrorism was endorsed by nations in the region, unfortunately during that time, my capacity was still as the commander in chief of Indonesian Army, but I heard about the situation. There is a kind of resistant among nations about how we define the threat of terrorism. In this regard, as maybe you may aware, that there is like a kind of evolution of the threat. As maybe you may aware also that back to 2001, it is a threat of Al-Qaeda at that time, and it is like the I consider that the first generation of terrorism. And there is an evolution, an evolving of terrorist threat in this region, and the second generation turned up to be the threat of the announcement of IS in Syria and Iraq back 2014. And now at this moment, we have the same common understanding about the threat of terrorism, which is the third generation of terrorism, the returning foreign fighter or the foreign militant to our region. So that's why it is becoming the foundation and it for every nation in this region to work together, and there is no more resistance related to this issue.
Thank you, Minister. Now, you mentioned Al-Qaeda. Even at the height of Al-Qaeda's interest in this region, their main purpose was looking upon here as the base for operational planning, for funding. That seems to have changed today. They are looking at this more as an operational theater. Is that correct?
Jadi tadi Bapak betul, Pak, menyampaikan bahwa potensi ancaman sebelumnya ada Al-Qaeda, Pak, yang sebelumnya ingin membangun suatu kekuatan di sini, termasuk juga basis operasi dan keuangan di sini. Tapi sekarang Al-Qaeda lebih melihat, Pak, saat ini bahwa kawasan ini sebagai daerah wilayah operasinya, Pak. Jadi tidak menjadi lagi pusat lagi. Apakah Bapak melihat hal ini suatu fenomena yang baru terjadi, Pak?
Ya, karena Indonesia itu bukan negara Islam, tapi penduduk Islamnya ada 200 juta dari 260 juta penduduk. Kemudian ya jelas ya perhatian mereka ke Indonesia juga termasuk Filipina. Dan memang betul ya Filipina ini ada pemberontak-pemberontak untuk mendirikan negara sendiri. Nah, ini dari sini juga mereka menjadi teroris setelah kembali dari Timur Tengah ya. Jadi kesimpulannya adalah teroris yang di Asia ini, terutama Asia Tenggara ini, ada dua negara yang besar, Indonesia dengan Filipina.
Yes, indeed. I would like to also highlight that the nature of population in this region, especially Indonesia. Indonesia is the world's largest Muslim country, and including in this region, there is also like a Muslim country, Muslim population in the southern of Philippines. So in this regard, it is naturally for sure like the kind of Al Qaeda will focus on Indonesia and like Philippines as the main hub of their collaboration, not necessarily only like the operational, but the also the base as well as the fund support. But with the nature of evolution, we can see there must be like a kind of shifting, their kind of pattern, especially how to consider like this region. With the nature of the population in Indonesia and the Philippines, we have like the Muslim community, so they will focus on a different area of operation and different pattern of operation, but as all centralized also with the Al Qaeda from their stronghold in the Middle East.
Thank you, Minister. Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned Philippines. Last year, something happened in Philippines that seized everybody by surprise. And of course, I'm referring to the siege of Marawi. I'm going to ask a very blunt question. Please forgive me. Did nobody see it coming, or did somebody see it coming and not say anything, or not say anything fast enough?
Jadi memang terkait dengan yang Bapak sampaikan itu betul, Pak. Dan bahkan ada sangat memilukan, Pak, tahun lalu kejadian adanya pendudukan di Marawi, Pak. Mohon maaf kami bertanya kepada Bapak, apakah memang belum pernah ada orang yang memberikan informasi intelijen tentang serangan Marawi sebelumnya, Pak, sampai harus ini harus terjadi, Pak?
Saya belum mendengar, tapi jauh sebelumnya Marawi saya sudah memperkirakan itu mereka akan kembali, pasti ada melakukan kegiatan di Filipina Selatan. Karena kenapa? Di sana banyak pemberontak-pemberontak yang Islam, terorisnya Islam bergabung di sana, aman. Setelah kembali pasti ada kegiatan meneror, terjadilah di Marawi.
Despite the fact that I've not been advised related to the potential of attack or siege of Marawi, but I make some prediction about the situation, noting the nature of the southern Philippine area. They have like a secessionist, military secessionist, as well as military rebellions with the motive of they try to establish like the part of Philippines, but based on the Islamic ideology. Based on my prediction that about 2 years before Marawi, I predicted that there must be some kind of escalation of situation in the southern Philippines, and that's actually my prediction turns to be true with the incident of Marawi.
See, thank you, Minister. Now, Minister, shortly after the siege went from May to October 2017. Shortly afterwards, you came up with OEI, otherwise known as the All Eyes Initiative, which derived its names from the Five Eyes Initiative comprising US, Canada, UK, Australia, and New Zealand. But this time with OEI, it comprised the six Southeast Asian nations of Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, Brunei, and Philippines. Was it the siege of Marawi that prompted you to come up with this?
Jadi Pak, setelah kejadian Marawi pada bulan Mei sampai September tahun lalu, Pak, Kemudian Bapak datang dengan konsep Our Eyes yang melibatkan 6 negara, Pak, setelah kejadian Marawi itu, Pak. Apakah konsep Our Eyes ini muncul setelah Marawi? Konsep Our Eyes ini apa muncul setelah Marawi? Dan konsep ini yang Bapak sampaikan seperti konsep Our Eyes, Five Eyes itu, apakah ini muncul karena setelah Marawi atau ada pertimbangan sebelumnya, Pak?
Ya. Jadi yang pertama, sebelum Our Eyes ini kita melakukan kegiatan untuk patroli bersama di Laut Sulu. Ya, segitiga Filipina, Indonesia, Malaysia. Memang itu daerahnya. Nah, ternyata hasilnya bagus. Karena dulu hampir tiap bulan banyak perompak. Merompak kemudian mereka minta ditebus. Jadi untuk cari uang mereka menahan orang. 2 tahun berikutnya itu tidak ada lagi. Dan sejak itu saya berpikir perlu intelijen, perlu mata dan telinga. Tanpa mata dan telinga yang banyak, ini akan susah mendapatkan informasi atau mengetahui kedudukan pasti. Untuk itu saya membuat ide, ya, itu membentuk Our Eyes. Saya melihat di Amerika ada Five Eyes, ya, di sini harus ada mata telinga juga, yaitu mata bersama, Our Eyes. Ya, awal-awalnya memang ada 6 negara tadi karena yang terlibat langsung. Ya, tapi ternyata semua sekarang mendukung, termasuk Amerika mendukung, Australia, negara Eropa mendukung. Karena yang Our Eyes ini tidak ada unsur politiknya, tapi murni untuk menghancurkan teroris. Jadi semua negara mendukung. Nah, ini yang membesarkan hati saya karena mendapat dukungan banyak, dan mudah-mudahan makin banyak dukungan, ya makin cepat kita tahu di mana kedudukannya, makin cepat kita menyelesaikan masalah teroris ini.
Prior to the Marawi seats, between the three countries, we already come up with the trilateral cooperative arrangement. Among others is the joint maritime patrol in this area. And it followed with the air patrol in this area. And it proves to be very effective and very successful and fruitful. And we can see that the incidence of piracy for ransom was less quite significantly after that, after we conduct this trilateral engagement. Then the Marawi happens. Based on this endeavor and followed with the Marawi seats, then I come up with I make some consideration that we need a kind of eyes and ear to support our operation, military operation. So it is very important that we have like kind of like very reliable sources and information and intelligence. So based on this consideration and my thinking, then I come with the initiative of the Our Eyes concept. The Our Eyes, actually, it is quite similar with the concept of the Five Eyes conducted by the Western country led by the US, and I can see the importance of this concept of Our Eyes. Then the initial announcement or officially announcement or but the soft announcement of this Our Eyes were at that time we involved like 6 countries that directly involved with the security situation in this region, especially in the Sulu waters. And after this concept has been submitted to the ASEAN member states, and most of the ASEAN agreed with my concept that they would like to join because they understand the importance of cooperation and collaboration among nations to fight terrorism, because they understand the definition of terrorism as the common enemy of the region. So after the ASEAN, we conducted also the meeting of ASEAN Plus Nation, and most the ASEAN Plus Nation also support this idea, including the American, the and also the European Union and also the Australia. So actually the evolution of our ASEAN concept based on your inquiries. Thank you.
Now, Minister, so with regards to the OEI, it seems that the nations came together very quickly. How do we, however, get past beyond the superficiality that, you know, tends to plague Southeast Asia when it comes to collaboration on security matters?
Jadi kami melihat, Pak, dengan konsep AORS langsung cepat berkembangnya, banyak negara langsung ingin bergabung, Pak. Tapi bagaimana mengkonkretkan AORS ini, Pak? Karena memang dalam implementasinya tentu harus memerlukan beberapa proses yang Bapak jalani. Bagaimana konsep Bapak untuk supaya ini lebih berjalan dengan sesuai dengan apa yang Bapak bayangkan?
Yang pertama kali kita dukungan itu yang paling penting. Ya. Nah, kemudian kita sudah membentuk di sini ada kemarin rekan-rekan dari ASEAN sudah datang ke tempat kita, kemudian sudah rapat apa yang harus kita lakukan. Yang penting adalah semua data-data, semua informasi di sini pusatnya, dan dari sini juga bisa disebarkan ke negara-negara yang diperlukan atau semua negara yang tidak perlu, nggak apa-apa, yang penting tahu tentang teroris itu.
Yes, it is important that the first phase that we should have is the will support, especially the sincere intention for from the nation to support this OEI, and after that, after we get the support, then there will be followed with the implementation of this concept, and the concrete step of this concept, we already established like the OEI center here in the Ministry of Defense of Indonesia, and just recently we have a visit from representative of ASEAN for the way forward, to discuss about the way forward of this OEI concept, and we also already deliberate how this mechanism of intelligence and information sharing supposed to be conducted, and maybe it is not some country maybe doesn't require some intelligence information because they are not affected directly with the terrorism, but among nations that has been that needs information, we will prepare to share this information among nation in this region. So it will be kind of like a sharing, like a big picture of the threat of terrorism.
Now, Minister, I know that Indonesia received a visit from Defense Secretary of United States, General James Mattis, earlier this year. How did the visit go?
Kami tahu, Pak, bahwa Indonesia baru saja menerima kunjungan Menteri Pertahanan Mattis, Pak, awal tahun ini, Pak. Bagaimana kunjungan tersebut berjalan, Pak?
Saya awali dulu. Hubungan Indonesia dengan Amerika sebetulnya baik-baik saja. Memang ada pasang surutnya, tapi yang baik itu banyak. Sejak saya jadi Menteri Pertahanan, ya saya sudah berhubungan baik dengan Amerika, terutama masalah pertahanan dengan dua Menteri Pertahanan sebelumnya. Nah, sekarang yang dijabat oleh Jim Mattis ini bertambah erat hubungan, terutama antara Kementerian Pertahanan, terutama lagi antara saya dengan Menteri Pertahanan Jim Mattis. Karena kenapa? Mungkin ya, kita sama dari tentara, pangkat kita juga sama, kebetulan tanggal tahun lahir kita pun sama. Jadi dengan kesamaan itu ya, kita bekerja sama, yang dilakukan sangat baik sampai sekarang.
Allow me to reaffirm the strong bilateral relations with, especially in the field of defense between Indonesia and the US. And is it this strong bilateral defense relation also happened before the visit of Secretary Mattis. And we have like a good communication and collaboration, despite the fact that we have like a ebb and flow of this relation between these two nations. But after the Secretary of State has been appointed as the Secretary of Defense, our relation is getting stronger and more stronger compared to previously. Even I have also a very good engagement and collaboration with his predecessor. But now I would like to acknowledge that the relation between myself and Secretary Mattis is never strong, been stronger. It is the, and it is never been better. Now the highest one. I would like to say that we have some commonalities, especially myself with Secretary Mattis. We were born in the same year, back to the 1950s, and we are both like four-star generals, and we are coming from the military background. So based on the commonalities, it is like the very strong base and underlying for establishing the more stronger defense relation. So that's why I would like to say that nowadays the defense relation between Indonesia is very, very strong and very close.
That's really wonderful to hear, and U.S. and Indonesia have definitely come a long way, especially from the 90s, back in 1991 to 2005. I think there were some sanctions that was placed on Indonesia because of human rights issues with Indonesian special forces. But fast forward to today, how many annual bilateral military-to-military engagements are we seeing?
Jadi Pak, saya melihat senang sekali Pak melihat perkembangan hubungan yang jauh lebih baik Pak antara Indonesia dan Amerika. Terutama saat ini dengan melihat juga latar, kembali ke masa lalu ketika hubungan tahun 91 sampai 2005 adanya sanksi-sanksi dari Amerika karena kaitan dengan faktor HAM dan juga berdampak kepada latihan dengan pasukan khusus. Tapi kami senang sekali dengan hubungannya sudah jauh lebih baik pada saat ini. Kemudian dalam konteks ini sudah berapa kira-kira berapa banyak Pak yang sudah dilakukan hubungan saling kunjungan pejabat kedua negara dan hubungan pertemuan-pertemuan antara Kementerian Pertahanan kedua negara Pak selama tahun ini Pak sudah berapa kali banyak-banyak?
Saya bertemu dengan Menteri Pertahanan Amerika kurang saya hitung-hitung ada 6 kali ya Mattis ke sini 1 kali saya ke Amerika 2 kali ketemu dan sisanya bertemu di Singapura. Setiap bertemu ya kita membicarakan masalah pertahanan sampai sekarang menyentuh ke masalah pribadi. Satu contoh anak saya juga terjun patah kakinya jemitis menganggap anak saya itu anak dia sendiri jadi dia urus untuk berobat ke Amerika itu sudah sampai ke titik yang pribadi. Jadi saya rasa luar biasa hubungan kami antara Menteri Pertahanan. Mudah-mudahan hubungan ini mencapai hubungan baik antara dua negara.
Indeed, we have quite a frequent meeting and engagement, especially myself with Secretary Mattis. This year itself, we already made like a kind of 6 time of meeting with Secretary Mattis, and also not to mention the meeting between the two defense ministry. In this regard, my relation with Secretary Mattis has evolved from only like the formal relation between these two defense ministry and two nation, now evolved to the more personal relations, and we have a very strong engagement. I would like to say that the 6 meeting that we had, among others, my visit to the U.S., including our meetings in Singapore, and also my visit to the U.S. for 2 times, including to Hawaii for the handover of these Pacific commanders, and now the relation is becoming more personal with him. And as I would like to highlight, especially his sincere support during the difficult times, especially that inflicting my family because of one my sons, which is in the military. He had like a skydiving injury and incident that impacting his lumbar bones, and Secretary Mattis give his emotional support to, and even he offered to my son to be treated in the U.S. military hospital in Washington D.C. That's something that I feel so moved and so touched with his offer. That's something like one of the I would like to one of the example of like how strong and how close my relation with the not only with the Secretary Mattis including with the US and especially yeah that's actually that's I would like to emphasize the importance of this relation between these two countries.
Thank you, Minister. I'm very sorry to hear about your son.
Kami sangat juga sangat ini juga, Pak, turut sedih juga melihat apa yang menimpa putra Bapak, Pak.
Nah, tapi ya saya gembira karena Mattis, berarti Amerika juga membantu secara pribadi, itu yang membuat saya senang, ya, dengan hubungan antara negara itu dimulai dengan pribadi-pribadi. Pribadi sudah baik, pasti otomatis akan menjadi hubungan antara negara yang baik.
Despite the fact that the incident that inflicting my son, but I'm very moved and very delighted with the support and the kind attention from the US, especially from Secretary Mattis. I would like to emphasize that the good relation starting from the personal relation between these two officials, then it can evolve to a more stronger that can influence the relation between the countries. So that's why that's very important that every good relation have to be started with the kind and sincere will and support.
Tapi ada kesan saya dengan General Mattis, ya. Kita bukan orang politik, yeah. Jadi kita bicara politik negara, politik Amerika, politik Indonesia. Jadi tidak menyangkut politik-politik praktis. Ini yang menggembirakan, ya. Kalau kita bicara masalah politik negara, berarti hubungan negara. Kalau kita bicara hubungan negara, ya itu kedekatan antara kedua negara.
Yes, what I would like to reiterate, I'm very impressed and very happy with my relation with Secretary Mattis, especially during this stage. We are not both coming from politician. We are not politician, but both of us we speak about nation or the state's politics. So this state politics, it is will denote something like the relation between two countries. So it can have the influence the relation between two countries. So it is very important that based on the personal and sincere relation between these two officials that can impact of the political relation among nations. So everything have to be started from the relation and sincere relations first. That's something that I would like to highlight.
Kita bicara karena kita bukan orang politik, tidak ada kita bicara politik, tapi memang bicara masalah pribadi dan negara. Jadi tidak ada yang menyimpang ke mana-mana.
Yeah. One more, I would like to emphasize that we are not politician, but we talk sincerely and openly, and both on transparency and good friendship. So this good relation can impact and influence the relation among nation. So we are not talking about politics because we are not politics, but I would like to say that with this kind of sincere relation and communication, then it can influence the good relation between the two nations. That's something like I would like to convey the message.
Thank you very much, Minister. I cannot agree more on the importance of personal relations and international relations, especially defense relations, where trust is very much needed. May I ask, during your meetings with General Mattis, if the lifting of sanctions on Caucasus was mentioned?
Saya setuju sekali, Pak, dengan yang Bapak sampaikan, Pak. Hubungan pribadi itu, Pak, itu membangun saling percaya antara kedua negara, dan saling percaya itulah menjadi hubungan yang baik untuk meningkatkan hubungan kerjasama antara kedua negara. Izin, Pak, kami juga izin bertanya, Pak, terkait dengan hubungan baik dengan Bapak, Pak, apakah ada juga disebutkan dengan rencana Amerika untuk mencabut sanksinya terhadap Caucasus?
Ya, sudah disampaikan mencabut Caucasus dan nanti akan latihan bersama lagi.
Yes, Secretary Mattis also hints this point about lifting the sanction of Caucasus Special Force. Then we plan to conduct like a military exercise between Special Force of Indonesia and the Special Force of the US. That's one of the points that we discuss also.
That's wonderful. Congratulations. Now, General, what is Indonesia's view or your views on America's posturing in this region? I see that they are framing great powers with China. Does Indonesia sometimes feel that you're placed in a hotspot between a hotspot and a rock, you know, having to choose and pick sides?
Bapak Jenderal, terima kasih. Tadi kami sangat gembira melihat hubungan yang baik dan perkembangan yang baik antara Indonesia dan Amerika. Dan terkait dengan konsep Amerika, Pak, dalam membangun posturnya di kawasan ini, Pak, kami melihat Amerika membangun suatu juga postur pertahanan yang relatif kuat di kawasan ini, Pak, dalam menghadapi definisi ancamannya yang menurut Amerika. Apakah ini juga berpengaruh terhadap cara pandang Bapak terhadap kerjasama dengan Amerika ini, khususnya di kawasan, di mana Amerika juga memandang kawasan itu sebagai kawasannya ada beberapa potensi ancaman Amerika, termasuk juga situasi yang memanas seperti Timur Tengah juga, Pak. Bagaimana Bapak melihat ini?
Saya rasa saya menyambut baik ya. Kalau dulu Pasifik, sekarang Indo Pacific lebih luas lagi, di mana keinginan Amerika supaya semua orang, semua negara bisa bernavigasi dengan baik, baik di laut maupun di udara. Saya dukung itu, tentunya disesuaikan dengan aturan-aturan hukum-hukum internasional. Saya sangat baik, bagus. Karena dengan demikian kita makin banyak lewat sana, ya kita makin banyak teman, ya teman. Ya. Itu yang kami dukung.
I would like to say that Indonesia would like to welcome any strategy or like the presence of the US, especially in this region, especially with the goodwill to support the stability and peace in this region. Yes, we understand the concept of the US that would like to broaden the concept of Pacific cooperation to Indo-Pacific, which is more broadened, that will, it is more inclusive to more nation in this region. Yes, we understand the concept of the US, then we would like to say that it is very important that we have to also respect the freedom of navigation as well as the overflight. So it is also very important. And the more nation and the more we feel secure in this region, especially to pass the sea lane, the important and the lucrative and very important sea lane, it is one of the basis of my acknowledgement and my position related my position for our relation with the US.
Thank you, Minister. And I think those of us watching could attest to United States courting Indonesia, because they were embracing, General Mattis was embracing the name change of part of the South China Sea to North Natuna Seas, as well as referring to Indonesia several times as the global maritime fulcrum or the regional.
Saya juga melihat beberapa pandangan Mattis yang mendukung Indonesia, Pak, selama juga mendukung konsepnya di Natuna, Pak, kemudian juga memandang Indonesia sebagai poros maritim dunia, Pak. Jadi kami lihat itu juga konsep Amerika dalam membangun hubungan Indonesia, mereka sangat mendukung dengan konsep Amerika Indonesia juga, Pak.
Saya rasa itu sama ya, Presiden Jokowi ya, Indonesia merupakan poros maritim dunia. Nah, kemudian itu keluar di dalam, dia membuat apa namanya tol laut, jadi menghubungkan, jadi membesarkan maritim ya. Nah, dengan adanya Indo Pasifik dengan poros maritim dunia itu sudah nyambung.
Yes, I believe the concept of the US, it is in line with the concept of our administration at the moment, especially under the President Jokowi, that we are focusing on establishing our maritime fulcrum or the so-called the maritime axis, especially Indonesia. And it is in line with the concept of Indo-Pacific. It is also in adherence with our concept of maritime fulcrum, where our President Jokowi also establish our more engagement in the maritime area, including to develop the sea toll, and also we would like to expand our role in this maritime area. So that's why there is no some differences between the concept of the US and the concept of Indonesia.
Jadi saya tambahan ya, tambahan Indo-Pasifik ini harus dijaga, karena setiap tahun ada 5 sampai 8 triliun US dollar jumlah uangnya lewat di sini. Belum lagi sepertiga minyak dunia juga lewat di sini. Kalau ini terganggu, berarti ekonomi dunia juga terganggu juga.
Yeah. I would like to add one more thing, that it is important that we have to maintain and foster security and safety and peace in this area, because this area is very lucrative and very important sea lane. There are alone 5 to 8 trillion US dollar will pass through the sea lane. Not to mention that it is also the 1/3 of the all transport will pass through the sea lane. So it is important. It is very important that we have to collaborate to ensure the security and the safety of the our common maritime full sea lane.
Thank you so much, Minister. I wish we have more time. I know you have a very tight schedule and you have to go. I just want to express my gratitude for you taking time out of your busy schedule to share your input with us today. Thank you so much, Minister.
Sebenarnya banyak sih banyak yang mau tanya, kami tanyakan, tapi memang kami tahu Bapak jadwal Bapak padat sekali, Pak, dan banyak
kepentingan.
Tapi terima kasih, Pak.
Bapak saya juga terima kasih atas kedatangannya jauh-jauh. Ya, mudah-mudahan yang kita omongkan ini bermanfaat untuk manusia. Ya. Terutama yang kawasan kita ini.
So allow me to extend my sincere gratitude for kindly coming to visit me and to have the interview today. I'm very happy to have this, and I really hope that these two productive relations between Indonesia and the US can be fruitful and productive not only for Indonesia and the region, but all for the all humanity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Minister. I wish you continued success in your relationship with United States as well. Thank you, sir.
Indonesia dengan Amerika, Pak. Terima kasih banyak, Pak.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Terima kasih.